Hey everyone, thanks for joining me today. So before we get started, as always, I want to do a quick prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Most sacred heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Okay, so I wanted to just let you know to make sure to check out our Facebook group, and that is Mary's Anawim. And if you're interested in the things that we're talking about, make sure to join and, you know, just answer a few questions, and hopefully you'll get, you know, right in. Okay, the next thing I wanted to tell you about is if you want to get to know us a little better, check out Holy Family. You know, I have so many videos that I want to upload onto Holy Family, but we don't always have internet connection because we don't have our own internet right now. So we're working on getting that. And then another thing is that we don't always have, we need a new computer basically, because a lot of the videos I spend all the time it takes to edit a video, and then it will not export because we need a new computer. So we're working on that too. So, you know, slowly but surely we'll be adding videos to Holy Family, just so you guys could get to know us. But you know what I do try to do is regularly put up on Facebook some things of what's going on with us, just because we don't always get to upload onto YouTube as often as we would like. So just check us out in those different arenas. And also, if you want to contact us, you can email me at melody@holyfamily.com. And that will be in the link below. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about simplicity. Simplicity and living in Mary's Anawim. First thing is that I was listening a while back to Father Ripinger's talk on simplicity. And I found it very interesting because he said that basically that simplicity is a virtue. And I never knew it was a virtue. So I found that really interesting because as he spoke more and more about it, he was saying that it's a virtue. And as he continued to talk about simplicity, I realized that, wow, that's a virtue like I really can connect with. I really think that, you know, a lot of the times we look at our weaknesses and like, oh, I don't have this, or I'm so bad at this, or I really need to increase in this. And I finally realized like, wow, simplicity is something that I think that God has given me as grace, you know? And I really wanted to share this with you because I really believe that it's part of the calling of those who feel called to a life in Mary's Anawim or like Mary's Anawim in another area. I have heard of other people doing little communities throughout our journey. One I had heard of was in Venezuela, in Texas, and another was just a general that it will occur because of the times we're living in, and that the church will be reduced to a mere remnant. And I think we're very close to that because a lot of people are just deceived into what's going on. And that is part of the great deception. It's beginning. It's already begun. So we have to be very careful, you know, very vigilant, and you know, try as much as possible to stay in prayer and in the state of grace so that we are not deceived. And so getting back to simplicity being part of the call, I wanted to emphasize that simplicity is not minimalism. Minimalism is very similar to simplicity, but it is different in the fact that minimalism is more of a physical aspect, right? And simplicity, like I said, is a virtue. So it's more of a spiritual thing. And you know what else? I believe that, you know, Satan is always trying to be God, right? And so he always does things that are like God, but can never compare to God because he's not God. And so minimalism is like this new age thing that's come out to rival simplicity. You know, I really believe that while God is calling his people back to a very simple life, right? He is not calling us to certain things like being green and your carbon footprint and all those type of things. While we are stewards of the earth and it's very important for us to take care of the earth properly, there's also a deception which goes with what I was saying, that, you know, Satan is always trying to compete with God. And so basically we have to be very careful not to fall into the worldly eco and green and all that kind of stuff. That is part of the matrix system. And we're trying to get, and you know, God, actually not us, God is trying to take us out of that and have something similar, but not exactly the same, because like I said, that is the deception that the enemy is putting out there and that God is allowing, because people want to, you know, do what they want to do. Like I said, in Romans, I don't have it right in front of me, but I know that in Romans, you know, St. Paul talks about God giving people over to their sins. Why? Because they desired it so much, you know what I mean? And God allows us to have free will. He wants to try and help us, but then eventually he just lets us, you know, do what we want to do. Now, let's go back to simplicity, right? Simplicity is not having more than you need. So I don't know about how everybody else is, but I personally cannot stand when my house has too much stuff. I'm constantly getting rid of stuff. I mean, every 3 to 4 months, I go through my things, you know, and I just say, okay, we are not using this. Get rid of it. Because I don't like clutter. I don't like to have so much stuff. And even like I was saying, right now, I want to reduce our household. And we don't even have a big house, you know? But I just feel like it's something in me that wants to constantly just, you know, live as simply as possible. And you know what? It helps with stress too. Like I noticed that when, you know, there's too much stuff around and, you know, it's hard to get things constantly organized, you know, so you're worrying about, oh, I got to organize this. At least this is my temperament. You know what I mean? I don't know. Maybe I'm the only one, but at the same time, we have to have a balance, you know, knowing that, well, I do need them. So, you know, I can't get rid of them, but I just need them in their place. But we need to get back to simplicity. Okay. We need to make sure that we don't have more than we need. And I think that in today's society, that tends to be more of a norm than an exception, that people just get more than they need, you know, and then, you know, it actually reflects on your spiritual life. It really does. Because when you have more than you need, you're either going to be in a depression because, you know, it clutters and it just, when you look at nature, because it reminds me of God and, you know, because God is the creator of nature. So, you know, it's very simple, you know, and you can breathe, you know, and you want your house to be like that. And so if you have too much stuff, you're going to be in clutter and can't really just take a breath of fresh air. And so this can bring about depression, which I believe is one of the part of the reasons that we have such depression, because the stuff and the clutter, it brings about, either we're trying to fulfill, you know, the emptiness that we feel when we don't have God in our life, or we're trying to just kind of occupy our lives, and then we become miserable, depressed, and lonely. So if you think about how it was before, right? People were poorer. They literally had what they needed. And, you know, with this, though, there was a lot more joy for the most part. You know what I mean? People who were poorer had more hope, had more faith. There was more kindness and generosity. I remember from our Little House on the Prairie, right? I remember this episode that there was this guy, he was pretending to be a pastor and he wanted to like build a church. Well, you know, that was his little gimmick. And so Mary went around with him to like collect money. And she said something. She said, I don't remember the exact quote, but it was like, isn't it funny how the poor people always give more than those who than like the rich? And that is so true, you know. And I know that people will automatically think like, oh, well, this rich person gave to that charity and blah, blah, blah. And a lot of those charities are honestly, they're just gimmicks. They're just, you know, kind of like the Clinton Foundation type of thing. You know what I mean? Even the Red Cross, I remember reading not that long ago that more of their money went to the corporation than it did actually to helping people. So I personally don't like to give to charity. I would rather give to a person in need, and very small organizations that I know, like, are definitely giving, you know, to the people. But for the most part, those rich people that are giving, it's a facade. It's not what we think it is. And I'm not saying everyone, because I don't know. But I from what I've seen and read and heard, it's a lot of them. It's, you know, it's not what we think. So for the most part, people who have less will give more because it's more from their heart, you know, than people who have an abundance. And I guess it goes back to what Jesus said about the widow who gave her last penny type of thing. So anyway, you know, we just want to make sure that we are not cluttered by things that take up all of our time to clean and organize, and even our mental time, like maybe, you know, so many electronics that, you know, take up all of our time. And then we kind of are ignoring the real important things, like taking time with God, taking time with our family, you know, and taking time to really just be and not be entertained or be distracted, you know, but to be a person, a human being, you know, part of God's family. Okay, I just wanted to mention that if you do notice that maybe I do have too many things, maybe I should get rid of some things. So what I would suggest is that you should either, or maybe you should do this, right? Make two piles, things that you know for sure that you're going to get rid of, you know, and maybe you have a bunch of rooms in your house or something, or a bunch of drawers, and, you know, just go one by one, even if it takes one day at a time, you know. I usually start in my children's rooms, and excuse me, it took me 1 week just to do my boys' room when I did this about 3 months ago. So it's almost coming up time. And I was actually thinking about doing it again, just not now, maybe like in another month, I'll probably do it again. You know, just go through that one room or that one drawer, whatever it may be, and say, oh, this I can get rid of. Maybe this I can try and sell. Okay. Now the selling part, right? So the, you know, the giving away part is easy. And I don't mean keeping it in a bag and wait for somebody to give away. Literally just take it to a thrift store or one of those outdoor containers that, you know, take clothing and things like that. Or call, I think it's Goodwill that they come and they take a, they bring a truck, you know, it's like, it, you know, they'll take larger things. But if it's things that you want to sell, right, this is my suggestion. Make a time limit, right? don't just say I'm going to sell it and then months go by and nobody calls for it and you're still like, well, I'm going to sell it. Years go by and you have it still in your garage and it's like, well, I really just want to try to sell it. At a certain point, it's not really going to get done. So what you need to do is make a time limit. So like for me, I had the children's clothes and I had a lot of nice clothes. And so I told David, I'm going to try and sell it, right? That's my husband. I told him I'm going to try to sell it. So what I did was, I mean, I literally had like 6 bags of clothes. I put some up on eBay. I was ready to sell them. And then it took a while. Like David was like, just get rid of them, just get rid of them. And I wanted to try and sell it and I didn't listen. And I ended up losing when I finally did sell like something. I mean, I made like $2 on it maybe. And it was like, okay, is this really worth it? Like, you know what I mean? Having to, you know, put the pictures up, then go to the post office, put it in, you know, all that, it takes time. And it's like, then I made like maybe $2. And sometimes I even lost $2. Like, and I'm like, okay, if I put it up higher, but then it's like, it's still, you know, you really can't sell clothes that expensive, really. You can't. So at the end of the day, I just ended up getting rid of them after I was going to wait 3 months, but then I think it was a month and a half that I ended up getting rid of them because it just wasn't working out. And I think that we need to do that. We need to make a time limit. Okay, I'm going to wait 6 months if nobody calls by this time, or I'm going to wait 2 weeks, whatever it might be, you know what I mean? And just try to get rid of it and not have an attachment to it, because that's where I think simplicity also comes in. You know, in our journey, right, we've moved a lot. Since 2008, since 2007 when we got married, we were in an apartment for about a year and a half. And then from there, in 2008, God called us to 2018. We have moved a lot. And through the moving, I know a lot of people think it's crazy and things like that. But through the moving, we have learned detachment, you know, detachment from people, detachment from things. And it's not that we don't like to have stuff. It's not that we don't love people, you know what I mean, that we get to know, or maybe even family, of course. But in our hearts, we no longer are attached to them. And that's important. That's an important part of the simplicity, living simply. And living in Mary Zanoim is very much about detachment from people and things. And it's hard. It's a hard thing. I remember when we first moved to Portugal, that was the first time God called us to go and do anything radical. Well, not radical, because we've done radical things before that, but just was, you know, a little different. And I cried. I cried leaving my mom and my dad at the airport, you know? But when 5-6 years later, when we had to leave, I was detached, and I love my parents, but I was detached. And I think that was important, an important thing, you know, that God has done for us, you know, to not be attached to the things of this world, to not be attached to, you know, our stuff and even people. Even me, I have to, you know, still in my heart, I might have attachments that God might be working in me. And we just all have to learn detachment. So the next thing I want to talk about is simplicity in eating. You know, I think that nowadays we have a lot of people who are talking about health, and that's a great thing. And I'm very much into health because God told me to start eating healthy. I started eating healthy, and little by little, you know, he healed me, and I have PCOS, and now I have four beautiful children, and I pray that he gives us more. You know, that would be a beautiful thing, but it all began with obedience to him, and then in obedience, I began eating healthy. And I think that that's a great thing that many people are talking about it nowadays. But there's something that I thought about recently. We need to get closer to nature. And that's why right now we're actually on a raw food diet. And I've noticed different changes that I'm not going to get into right now that are good for the good. you know, but it relates to simplicity because it's simplicity in eating. Just eating a salad, you know what I mean, is so much closer to nature than a burger and fries, you know? It's not as fulfilling to our flesh. That I can say. To our flesh, it's not as fulfilling. However, it is much closer to the way God created us. You know, when you think about Adam and Eve in the garden, they were literally picking their fruit straight from the trees. And you know, we have a berry tree. And when the berries are ripened on the vine or on the tree, and I just go out there and I literally can just pick and pick and pick and pick, and it's delicious. But then when I bring them inside and I put them in the refrigerator, it's not the same. Nobody really likes to eat them from the refrigerator. It's so weird. So it just, you know, makes me think of Adam and Eve living in the garden, how much fulfilling it was to just grab from the tree and eat it. So I think we need to get back to that, and that will be part of Mary's Anawim, you know, just eating simply. And something that it reminded me of is a quote from Father Ripinger when I was listening to him talk about fasting. And he said, "Fast well on Fridays and feast well on Sundays." So this has been our little mantra. You know, on Fridays, we want to try and hurt our bodies, essentially. You know, fasting is to feel pain and hunger, you know. And even all throughout the week, we should just be eating simply. And on Fridays, it should be a little bit harder. And then on Sundays, we feast. That's the day that we can have a nice meal that's a little different or whatever, you know. On Sundays is when I generally will make maybe a chicken or, you know, just like a bigger meal or whatever. And then the rest of the week is just pretty much very simple meals. Maybe rice with eggs if we're going to have a cooked meal. Or like I said, salad. Sometimes salad with salmon. Something very simple and closer to nature. You know, a lot of the foods nowadays are so far from nature. Like you just look at a can or even like if you're just trying to eat something from the supermarket and you're like, oh, I'm just going to get fruits. But then that fruit is not, it's not grown in the way that God would have had it grown. It has pesticides and herbicides and things that will make it bigger. And then they put this layer to make it look shiny, and it's just nasty, really. So, we need to eat as close to nature, and that's why I advocate for organic and local. And what else? Organic and local and simple. Yes, those three are like the basis for a lot of our meals. That's why I love gardening, even though I'm not the best gardener. But a little something always comes out, so that makes me happy. So this all comes back to the times that we're living in. If you know anything about prophecy, and hopefully if you know, you don't, you'll go and look up, there's a great documentary on the Third Secret of Fatima. So back in 2008, God started to tell us about Our Lady of Fatima. He clearly woke me up one morning and told me to begin to say the rosary daily. I was not previously doing that. I was doing that at one point, and then I fell off. And then he woke me up that one morning in October of 2008, and he clearly told me to begin to pray the rosary every day. And I, praise be to God, I obeyed. And he started to reveal Our Lady of Fatima. He called us to Portugal. And since then, we've learned about the traditions of the church, the Latin Mass, the true faith. And we have so much more learning to do, trust me. You know, we're all on our journey. But the big thing that I believe he told us this was because of the chastisement. And I believe that he wants a mission church And he wants a small community that will hold the true faith, live together in charity, and live a life of penance. And we will be going through the fulfillment of the chastisements foretold by Our Lady, which has already begun. Okay? It's not like, you know, it's not like we're waiting for it. It has already begun. The material chastisement has begun. And we see it in our world around us. And if you don't, then unfortunately you're blind and you're in the matrix. And you need to wake up. And you need to come to the true faith. We must live simply. We must live in a penance. And the penance, right? It's going to be a life closer to nature. Primitive living. You know, I remember when I first found out about Nourishing Traditions, Dr. Weston A. Price. And he went around to primitive villages in the 1930s that were living away from society. Okay? That were living differently. And this one village, the Swiss village, is the one that always stuck out in my mind. They did not have the influenza. There will be plagues coming. Okay? We will be living in a way that God will protect us by His grace for those who really feel called to this. I really don't want to take up too much more time. I'm going to try to finish this within the next few minutes. But that Swiss village and not having not one case of influenza, because they were Catholic. They lived a primitive life, quote unquote primitive. I don't like to use that word, but it's just it brings to mind what I need it to bring to mind. And there's a YouTube channel. There's two YouTube channels that I've been watching that show a lot of way, like a lot of good skills to learn for primitive living. And I'm excited because we're going to be doing one of them soon. So just to test ourselves out. So this is what Anne Mary's Anawim will be like. Small homes, simplicity, closer to God, nature, and one another. A life of penance and charity, holding the true faith, which has been passed down from the apostles. And I'm going to be honest, there is one thing that will be hard for me, and that is being closer to others. And it's not because, like, I love, like I said before, having my home open for others to come. But because I'm introverted, there is this one thing for me that will be hard. And it is the intermingling so much with others. But I know that this is what God wants. So it's not all about what's going to be easy, what I desire, what I like. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be everything I desire. It's not going to be everything I like. But it's going to be what God wants. And that's what's utmost important. So to close, I just want to remind you to check out our Facebook group, email us, and check out our Holy Family YouTube page to get to know us a little better. Thanks for listening. And, you know, make sure to comment below. I will be censoring comments, though, that you know, as much as I can, because I don't need a bunch of uncharitable comments. All right, everyone. May God bless you today and always.